European gas market has found itself in a very challenging situation, I would rather say, in the past few years. Lots has been said about the dependence of Europe on, for example, a single supplier. We do know that about 60-70% actually of European gas is being supplied by two countries, by Norway and Russia. We have some elements here that we need to always put in the every discussion around the European gas markets, which is that the fact that indigenous gas supply, gas production in Europe is declining at a very alarming rate. And this comes from a very recent development that happened in the Netherlands, where there was a political decision to stop any production by the famous Groningen field, which is the largest single field in Europe producing gas. We are looking at about 45 BCM of production in annual terms that will be off the system, off the European system, within 2 years' time. So this is a major development that is indeed affecting their neighbors, the United Kingdom, which is one of the largest gas markets in Europe. However, you know, looking at, more to the east, you have Germany as the largest single gas market in Europe, and then Italy, one of the more developed, oldest markets, gas markets in Europe. Even if we do not anticipate, based on all the projections that we see from you know, analysts and from very respectable consultancy companies giving their forecast for the future, even if gas demand in Europe stays the same and not increase, we will still have a big gap to fill from the decrease in the indigenous gas production in Europe. Now, this creates a lot of opportunities at the same time, along with the challenges that we might face on the way there. We will probably see Europe as being the destination of some US LNG or other LNG, other meaning from other countries, either from Middle East or from Australia or from wherever the cargoes might get to Europe. But at the same time, in terms of all these geopolitical discussions that take place recently, we will need to collaborate and work closely with the existing major supplier, which is Russia, because just for last year we had record supplies by Russia. We've reached about 200 BCM of imports from our northern borders. So a lot of discussion that takes place around some sensitive infrastructure, pipeline infrastructure, needs to be considered with at least, I would say, with some skepticism in terms of you know, the initial reactions that one might have. I'm referring, of course, to Nord Stream 2, which is a Western European project, if you wish, connecting directly Russia to Germany. And at the same time, we have the Turk Stream, which will be supplying within the next few weeks gas Turkey, with gas Turkey, the Turkish market. There is a plan for the second line now, which would have the additional capacity, of course, to supply now Europe from the Turkish borders via the Greek borders, then to the European market. That would be one option. There are other options discussed for this pipeline to reach Bulgaria directly from the Black Sea. So you can understand that Southeast Europe again is at the heart of the discussions when we're looking at the European gas system, because it's not only TAP, it's not only the Southern Corridor which is underway, it's being built. It will be supplying Europe, the European part, with 10 BCM of gas. It's in terms of the overall European gas demands, when Europe is importing about 350 BCM of gas per year, you can understand that we would be needing far more than the Azeri gas reaching Europe. It is a very important project. It allows diversification of supply. It allows for greater competitiveness in the system. But we would definitely need more sources of supply. LNG is coming into support of all these elements, and that's why we have also the proposal here in the Greek territories of the Alexandroupolis LNG in northern Greece, which will be another terminal LNG terminal that will be importing gas via LNG. And I think that puts again Greece at the spotlight, but with a positive, in a positive way, because we will be allowing the greater Balkan area to try also to diversify their own supply sources. Some markets, like for example the Serbian market or the Bulgarian market, are 100% dependent on Russian gas. At the same time, TAP will be serving the Bulgarian market, but not really reaching the Serbian market yet. Having also the additional option to import gas by LNG via the Alexandroupolis terminal in Greece, I think will give a strong negotiation card, if you wish to, the countries that are fully dependent on one supplier or two suppliers perhaps. So having a portfolio of different gas sources, I think it always helps, both in terms of getting a better price or getting a better negotiation in the end for the product, for the volumes that you need for your own market, but at the same time helps in the geopolitical discussions, because energy, fortunately or unfortunately for some, it is very highly interrelated, if you wish, with geopolitics. And being able to have choices, it's always much better. Also at the European level, Spain has a lot to show as far as the its LNG industry is concerned, because it has been highly developed over the past 40 plus years. Spain has the largest capacity of LNG imports among all European countries. They have seven operational LNG import terminals at the moment. They have been at the forefront as well of the small-scale LNG developments in terms of supplying the industry or supplying cities that are remote with the product, with LNG. They know very well the business, and actually we are very fortunate here in Greece to connect also with our existing situation here, that with the recent privatization process of DESFA, or the gas TSO here in Greece, which includes an operational LNG terminal in Revithoussa, import terminal in Revithoussa. We have, of course, the Italian TSO SNAM leading the process, but as part of the consortium, you also have Fluxys from Belgium and Enagas from Spain. So they all bring on the table their own expertise from various aspects of the gas business. SNAM has the largest network, gas transmission network in Europe. This is very good for us to have them on board. Enagas, they are experts in terms of LNG tracking, for example, in terms of running, operating LNG import terminals, and at the same time, Fluxys is one of the, also the leaders in Europe in terms of applications for LNG bunkering, which Greece is a very particular area, if you wish, of the world, of Europe, that LNG bunkering can actually work and has a lot of commercial applicability. So all these three, they have ingredients that I think, if they make it work very well in the case of DESFA, I think Greece has a lot to gain from their participation in the asset here. Should there be enough commercially exploitable gas reserves in the greater area there of Southeast Med, around Cyprus, Israel, Lebanon, Egypt, there have been a number of discoveries recently that are supporting, if you wish, this observation that we do have a lot of reserves there. If they are commercially viable, then you have a project pipeline, which is the East Med pipeline, which can be a viable solution for transporting all these gas reserves. A number of those reserves are going to be European gas reserves now, which connecting to the discussion we had about the indigenous depleting gas resources in Europe, that would definitely be of support to the European situation. I think a project like the East Med Pipeline is an important EU project. It's been supported from the European Commission, being a PCI project of common interest project. However, at the moment, is not a bankable project yet. It is a very expensive project, technically feasible project. However, we need to identify more resources that can be put into work for this pipeline so that they can sell the gas to the European markets. The fact that there is a collaboration, strong, close collaboration with Israel, which has also huge reserves, a non-EU country, however, a close ally of the European Union as well, as we have seen also from all the trilateral and bilateral meetings and collaboration agreements that have been signed in the past few years. I think a greater collaboration at the energy collaboration, at this energy level, of the greater region with all the instability and the other geopolitical tensions that the region has, I think it would act as a very good sign of you know, further future collaboration and smoothening of the tension that that exists in the region. Develop further the, you know, the economic collaboration between the countries. If you have a win-win situation for all the players involved, I think that can also help, as I said earlier, to smoothen a little bit out the other political tensions that might exist in the region. We do see a lot of developments in Egypt recently, so this is another country that is in that region, a non-EU country, that with the recent Zohr discovery and other discoveries that have happened in offshore and onshore Egypt in the past 2 years, they have changed completely the landscape of the region in terms of gas, because from a gas importer, Egypt is expected to become very soon a gas exporter again. So you have two LNG export terminals, so two liquefaction plants that exist in Egypt that they have been sitting idle for the past few years, because Egypt at the same time was importing a lot of gas via the means of FSRU, the floating storage regasification units. And what we see now is that there might be commercially viable projects bringing some of this gas that we said earlier that has been discovered in Southeast Med from Cyprus, from Israel, potentially in the future from Lebanon, to Egypt, to the terminals that Egypt has, because the investment is already there. It has, you know, we're talking about a sunk investment, plants that have been built, money have already been spent, and they are not utilized. Looking at the prospects of the region in terms of the gas discoveries that we have seen in Southeast Med, we also need to take into consideration, of course, another major player in the region, which is Turkey. Turkey is the largest gas market in that region. We're looking at a 50 BCM market. This is almost 10 times the gas market of Greece. TAP is the European part of the pipeline, but when we're looking at gas coming from Azerbaijan, we also need to think of TANAP, which is a Trans-Anatolian pipeline, the part that crosses through Turkey. So even these new gas supplies reaching Europe from Azerbaijan, they pass through Turkey. So you have even the new Russian supplies that are coming to Europe via Turkey. So Turkey established itself as a very big transit country for gas, at least. It's not only a big consumer, but also at the same time, a lot of gas is transiting through Turkey, which of course passes then to the European borders via the Greek borders. At the same time, if you start considering what happens in the Southeast Med region, if you have new gas reserves wanting to reach the European gas markets, one of the supply routes, of course, that is under discussion is to go via Turkey, which in its own right has some difficulties, because you can have two ways of reaching to the Turkish market with a pipeline from the source, from Cyprus, from Israel. That would be first either onshore, which means that they will have to cross through Lebanon and other territories that politically speaking, that makes it a little bit difficult for it to happen. And the second option would be offshore and via the Greek Cypriot waters that, of course, you know, with the situation with the occupation of the island from the Turkish side, it makes it almost impossible again to happen. Of course, greater collaboration in the energy sector in terms of the exploration of oil and gas reserves in the region would help in reducing the tension there. We have seen, unfortunately, recently again a lot of disruptions happening from the Turkey side into towards not only Greek companies, but we're looking at international oil majors that are exploring the Greek Cypriot waters with licenses granted by the Cypriot government. Of course, with the concession of the European Union, and we still see, the Turkish government also interfering with this exploratory, if you wish, works taking place there. So, yes, energy can help in terms of creating stability in the region, but we have seen that Turkey has not been as much as a reliable player recently, and the only thing that we can be hoping for is for reducing a little bit the tension, which is really necessary, and so further economic collaboration between the countries in the region, I think, can help towards that direction. Greece has all of the potential to become a gas hub the moment we have gas infrastructure in place. So, at the first stage, I think it's extremely important to have more interconnection in the region, in the Balkans. The IGB is moving towards that direction, and I think it's fastly moving forwards. We expect to have the final FID decision within 2018, or within this year, to start construction, because very soon the IGB needs to transport also the Azeri gas, which will be passing through Greece via TAP. So the TAP project is also almost in place. At the same time, I think we should be developing also the gas storage capacity that we have in Kavala. There is an underground gas storage facility there, which is an old gas depleted field, which can be converted into gas storage. We must say that the region, especially Greece, does not have any gas storage available, as is the case with the rest of Europe. So taking that into consideration, alongside the fact that the LNG terminal in Alexandroupolis, which can be another second entry point for LNG in the country, having already Revithoussa in place, Greece can play a significant role in terms of becoming a hub in the region, since you will have existing flows from the north with Russian gas, maybe new gas flows with Russian gas coming from Turkey, with Turkstream, Azeri gas flows, maybe Southeast European, Southeast Med gas flows, as we discussed with the East Med pipeline, or with other LNG option so that we discussed from Egypt. And taking all this into consideration, I think Greece can really play a key role, a leading role, in terms of the gas trade around the greater Balkan region.